Come on! Need you to share this. It's Wednesday night Bible study, and I'm telling you that you have made it out all right. That's right. You made it out all right. Come on, share this. Get as many people in as you can. That's right. You have made it out all right. And I'm excited tonight to share the word with you tonight. Tonight, it's Bible study right here in the Walk of Dominion. Well, no, we've been away for some time, but we are back to share the word of the Lord on tonight. As you already know, this is our year to be aligned and assigned. And our annual memory verse, John 15 and 16, right there on the screen, simply says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you." Let me make it large on the screen for you. "That you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain, and that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he shall give it to you." I'm excited about what God's been speaking to us here in the Walk of Dominion, an exciting time. It's the month of October, that's right, the month of October. Our theme is to occupy until he comes. That's right, our theme is to occupy until he comes. I'm excited. October memory verse, let me make it large for you. Luke 19 and 13 simply says these words, "And he called the 10 servants and delivered to them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy until I come." Or in other words, the word means do business until I come. Simply is to say that God expects for you to occupy and to do business in the realms where he's given you access and realms where he's given you opportunity. But if you're not willing to be able to stand in place, as we said on Sunday, take up space, somebody else will do it for you. This coming Sunday, I want you to join in with us. That's right. This coming Sunday, we're going to be talking about celebrating all the survivors, all of those who have had to survive domestic violence. We want you to make sure you join in with us to support them and to celebrate them in terms of the victory God's given them. Then the next Sunday, the 17th, Breast Cancer Awareness. We want to make sure that you tune in and make sure that you invite somebody, bring somebody. Again, we're championing all survivors, those who have survived breast cancer. And then finally, the 24th, last Sunday in the month, can't believe it, the Lord has allowed me to stand in place for 15 years, second generation preacher standing where my father stood, declaring the word of the Lord. Want you to join in with us. We're going to be practicing social distancing on that day. We're going to have a family meal right after the service. So we'll be doing that, practicing social distancing, masks, hand sanitizers. Come on and join in with me. I still believe, I'm one of those that believes that when there's a connection between pastor and people, anything is yet still possible. So I want you to share that. And then I need you to get every woman that you can and tune right in, register. It's free. Women of Destiny with a great mentor to my wife and also many women on the peninsula. Dee Vines, wife of Willie Vines there from Bethel Temple. Want to make sure, ladies, that you register. Let me tell all pastors, all leaders, all of those who are interested in seeing God's hand move in the life of women in such a special way, I want to make sure that you invite every woman that you can. Lady from here, from the Walk of Dominion, she'll be speaking Saturday morning, 10 a.m. Make sure you go right there to the website on the flyer. Get the information. Get the link. Share it with another sister. Get as many in as you can and make sure you tune in Saturday morning. It's virtual. She's going to be sharing the word. Make sure you're there 10 a.m. Saturday morning. And also, they open up on Friday night right there at 7 p.m. Go to the website, get the information, share it with as many people as you can. If you haven't shared this yet tonight, I need you to do so right now. It's about time for us to get right into tonight's word for what the Lord wants to say to us here in the Walk of Dominion. I'm excited about what God's doing, and I'm excited about the word of the Lord for us here on tonight. So tonight, again, our theme on Sunday and on Wednesdays is to occupy till he comes. Tonight, taking up space, whose authority is it anyway? Whose authority are you going to occupy with? Come on, quickly, let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for my brother and sister who's watching tonight on this stream. Thank you for those who are tuning in and making their way into the broadcast tonight. Father, I've prayed that tonight's word will begin to settle down in our hearts, that we come to understand by whose authority do we operate in order to occupy and take up space from our adversary. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, somebody type it in for me. Occupy. Whose authority is it anyway? Whose authority? Just type in the word authority. Come on, let's get started with this tonight. So listen, as we've stated over and over, our times aren't changing, but they have changed. If you're not aware of that, our times are not changing. The reality is that our times have already changed. The quadrants of world societies, particularly in the West here, are beginning to blur the lines of demarcation. You know, we used to have a separation of institutions, a separation of marketplace, a separation of different communities, but all of them are beginning to converge and beginning to come in place. If I could say it this way, if you have not yet been heightened before with an understanding that there's getting ready to be an access toward what I would call one world government, you had better get ready and get prepared, because my friends, that is on its way. It'll be here sooner rather than later. Come on, let me get back into this word tonight and keep right on walking with us. So listen, having understood that what used to separate institutions, markets, economies of scale, values, morals, beliefs have become a slippery slope, a relativistic context. And so literally what that means is that we're spending a lot of time trying to have a better understanding about what God's doing in the earth, what he's doing in the world, and what's going on around us, where we could easily tell what was representative of the kingdom, what was representative of God, and what was not. But now the lines are becoming blurred so much so that we really can't tell. Somebody type it in for me. Whose authority? Whose authority? Whose authority? Come on, now listen. Although the concept of context, listen to me tonight, is critically important in how we make decisions, context should not be the sole determinant of how we plan to live and with whom we plan to live and in relationship with. Context should not just determine that by itself. Unfortunately, context and the idea of with them, that's right, a what's in it for me mentality has become the litmus test for how even we as believers make decisions. We approach our relationship with God with the same understanding. We oftentimes come with our petition prayers already laid out. We talk to God as if he works for us, and we begin to lay before him the things that we want to see rather than beginning to ask God, Lord, what's on your heart? What's on your mind? What are the things that you want to get done? And I think it's high time, my friend, that we get back to that of beginning to seek the Lord. Listen, our humanistic thought patterns tend to override universal truths of, watch this, history, culture, and even science itself. Our tendency in our time to really be so self-centered that we can really move beyond history and its substance, culture of present time, and even science itself as we begin to make decisions. So listen, when we say humanistic or humanism, that means that is when we believe man is the center of all things. We tend to consider our own thoughts, needs and wants and desires with no conscience of consequence. Isn't it a crazy thing that we live in times where people often believe they can get away with anything, do anything, and they really believe the world revolves around them? My question to them tonight is, by whose authority does everything revolve around you? By whose authority does everything have to line up with how you see it? Or everyone got to play by your rules, or people got to be on your page? By whose authority do you get to make that kind of a decision? And so tonight, my friends, I think we've gotten to a place where we've got to really be careful about how we go about seeing the world And I think it's time that we've got to understand, we've got to come back to seeing the world, what I would say, from God's perspective. Look at this tonight. Look at this. I want to show you this on the screen. Let me make it large for you. You see this showing up in these different areas. You see it showing up in these different areas. Check this out. Look at this. We see it tonight. We begin to see it in rearing our children. They are slow. There's a slow response to follow instructions with our children. Check this out. Even with all of that and that slow response that they can tend to have from time to time, let me go back to that one. The reasoning of I don't want to because I don't have to when it comes to chores and following instructions. Isn't it crazy? Is it just me? But are we living in a time where it seems our children have a whole lot of extra to say in terms of communicating with us? Now, I'm not talking about being inquisitive and thinking through and making sure that we make sense of things. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about when you're giving instruction, when you're trying to raise them, when you're trying to shape and to form them. They've got so many impacts and influences coming in, and I think we've got a lot of extra stuff that's giving them license to be able to do things that generations previous before them could not do. And I want to say this real quickly with that tonight, and this relativism and this contextual stuff that we're looking at, everything is not always about my sensibilities and I need to go to somebody's therapy somewhere. No, some things are really about us being cultivated, us being developed, us growing, and so that we become mature, responsible adults and also mature believers. But Satan would have it that it shows up in how we are rearing our children, that we're afraid to discipline. We're afraid to correct. We're afraid to begin to set standards for them and help them develop and begin to grow. Even the Bible says these words to us. The Bible begins to say the Lord chastens or corrects or disciplines even those he loves. You can always tell when Satan is at work because he hates discipline, instruction. Really, he is in and of himself by his own authority, but that's not tonight's teaching. Come on, let me go into the next slide, the next screen for us. Check this one out right here. We see it showing up in marriage and family relationships. We see when it is, we see it in the continued constant breakup of marriage and family. We continue to see it when the impact of divorce and domestic violence and adultery and single parent households, where people are, where those of us as adults, we get outside of godly order. We get outside of biblical mandates. We get outside of how the Spirit would lead us to operate in relationship with one another. So now, husbands and wives are arguing with each other. The children are stressed out. We can't seem to communicate and be able to get on the same page. Somebody typing in, Pastor, I know that's right. Here it shows up again, the tenor of our times in political and economic uncertainty. Look at this. When the current pandemic is causing stock prices to plummet on goods and services, both durables and non-durables, you can't necessarily trust what's being said out of the mouths of politicians as they argue with each other back and forth between who's going to have and who's not going to have and how things are going to take place and not how things are not going to take place. I got a question tonight. By whose authority do they get to determine all of that in terms of how they're going to make decisions, bickering back and forth one to another when we, the people, are beginning to suffer? I would quote the Constitution tonight, but it's Bible study. Maybe I could. We, the people, in order to form a more perfect union, come on, do establish. Listen, y'all, it really lies in our hands. We really have the authority. We really have the power. It shows up even more. Look at this. Intentions of changes in the tenets of faith and doctrine, even in the church. I would think that the last place of truth would be the church that would hold to some sense of orthodoxy. It's showing up even in the church. Look at this, where the bishops of the Anglican Church and many of the Episcopal Church have already begun to endorse the tenor of the times with same-sex marriage, already now become the law of the land, and in many states constitutionally here in the West being protected by that. What in the world is going on? Look at the bottom of the screen. What in the world is going on when Ebony Magazine puts out an article that says the coolest black family in America, number 10 begins with O.C. Allen and Rashad Burgess, the two, the pastor and bishop and first gentleman. How far have we slidden away in our value shift where we're making everything about us and we're no longer making it about God and his word and what his standards are? Now, tonight, I'm not necessarily here tonight to do a lot of bashing, but tonight I want to have some reporting tonight by way of the Spirit that we're drifting away from God's original intent and purpose in our society at large, the marketplace, the family, the church, and even government itself. We're beginning to drift away. And the question tonight that I'm asking is, by whose authority is all of this happening? And these things are taking place so much so that they're beginning to now formulate a posture inside of even your own house. Come on, let's get into this tonight. Somebody type it in, by whose authority, by whose authority. So listen, all of these values and shifts and changes are a result of a great deception with our adversary. He is the culprit behind this. Our adversary has posed the same question in the garden that he did to the woman. He is saying, hath God said? This issue about hath God said, or what did God say, or what did he mean when he said, or how did he say that, or under what context did he say that, or is the scripture even relevant or not, or why do we, is there even a God, or these ideas and concepts come directly from him because the issue is about power and control. The issue is about power and control. Type it in. Power and control. That's what the issue is all about. It's all about power and it's all about control. Come on, let me go into this board some more tonight. In other words, where does our authority lie to determine our destiny, to live out our life purpose, to parent our children? Where, by what authority do we do that? To establish our enterprises, to live in our relationships one to another? Where does that authority come from to do that? What our adversary has done has made us feel as if we are powerless, as we are powerless victims being controlled by a big state in all the sectors of life. He's causing us to begin to reject God's word and to begin to reject what it is that God has had to say to us, so that we're now beginning to question God. We're beginning to question his authority. We're beginning to question who he is. And listen, let me say this to us tonight. When we begin to question who God is, God didn't have a problem with you asking him questions. What he has issue with is when he gives you a response and then you still choose to go do your own thing. My God in here on tonight is getting ready to get what I call bad English, but good theology, gooder and gooder and gooder. Come on, if you haven't shared this, I need you to do it now as we get ready to get into the meat of tonight's teaching. So let's go. Here's the deception of the adversary. Our adversary has convinced us that somehow we're not in control if we don't make our own decisions. He's convinced us that somehow we're missing something, that we're not living the best of life, that heaven doesn't have our lives in mind by design if we choose to bring ourselves in connection with God by his authority. The encouragement is to what Aleister Crowley would say, known Satanist, do what thou wilt. In other words, the encouragement by our adversary is for us to be our own standard, for us to be our own authority, for us to be our own gods. Do what thou wilt. And you can see that the tenor of that is seeping into every sector of society all throughout the world. When we do that, our adversary becomes worshiped. But I got a word for him tonight, that Jesus Christ still is Lord. Hell, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth, that El Shaddai is still mighty, that Jehovah Jireh still provides. I want to say to somebody tonight, you're not missing anything when you choose to keep your connection with the Lord God. Lord, let me get into this tonight, because God's intention is that you would begin to occupy on his behalf in the realms, in the spheres, in the spaces that he's putting you in. This, my friends, opens us up to being controlled when we choose not to, by unclean spirits like the man from the Gadarenes, from Gadara. We become robbed when we choose to do things independent from God. We become robbed of our mental faculties in order to make sense of things. Is it just me, or have we gotten to a place where it seems like there's a whole lot of just irrationality, crazy behavior? Preacher friend of mine has said to me one time, it's almost as if people have, humanity is losing its mind. But I got a word for that tonight. Let your mind be renewed as it is in Christ Jesus. Come on, look at this. We become robbed of our will. We become robbed of hope, love, joy, and peace. We become robbed of personal fulfillment when we walk away from the Lord our God and his ways and the tenets of our faith and our confidence and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We become robbed of really the authority already given to us, but by our relationship with Christ. I want to say to us tonight, it is absolutely possible for us to live an overcoming, victorious, what I call walking in dominion kind of life through our connection with Christ Jesus. And it is our adversary who wants us to be taken away and robbed away and to move away from him to do what we will. By whose authority would you do what thou wilt? Whose authority is that? Our memory verse reminds us, watch this, that a part of the command, let me make it large on the screen for you, that a part of the command that we have, the part of the command that we have of Christ is that we would occupy. Look at this. That word occupy there in that text means to do business in the spheres of influence that he has given us to extend the kingdom of God on his behalf. Occupying is about extending the kingdom of God, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit on behalf of the heaven. We have been given godly authority to do that in our homes, with our children, even as we enter in the marketplace and as we gather and formalize the church. Think it not strange that we're everywhere in our society, theme parks, vacations, grocery stores, community centers, regular parks. We're going about life as normal, as usual. And I'm not here tonight, I'm not trying to shame and have a whole thing about vaccinated versus unvaccinated. But I think it's interesting that there's a push to get back out into society everywhere but the local church. I think that's quite strategic, because what our adversary understands is that unless they have a preacher, how can they hear? And it's great that even you're watching this stream tonight, you're catching me online, this is good. But there's still nothing like being assembled together, gathered together with the energy that we connect and bring toward each other, where we as witnesses begin to come together and agree as touching. What does the text say? Nothing shall be denied us. Come on. And so tonight we're talking about by whose authority do we occupy? Somebody type it in, occupy, occupy, occupy. So here's a critical key point. A critical key point to remember is that authority is not given without responsibility. Let me just make this one large on the screen for us tonight. Listen, authority is not given without responsibility. And here's the second one. All authority is delegated. Hear me tonight. It presumes that you are in proper relationship with the giver of that authority. All authority is delegated. And to understand that when you're operating in a sense of authority, it presumes that you're in proper relationship with the one that is the giver of that authority. Jesus himself is our example. He never speaks in and of himself on his own. He always speaks of his relationship with the Father. Come on, let me make it large on the screen for you. Check him out right here in John 14 and 10. He says, "Do you believe," to his disciples, "I am in the Father and the Father in me?" He says to them, look at it. "The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me, he does the works." Come on, watch Jesus. John 1 and 18. "No one has seen God at any time, the only begotten of the Father, who is the bosom of the Father, he has declared him." Come on, John 14 and 9. Look at it right here on the screen. Jesus said to him, "I have been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip. He who has seen me," look at Jesus, "has seen the Father." So how can you say, "Show us the Father"? Jesus did not speak in and of himself. Everything he said was of the Father. So watch this. He's a man under authority. Watch Jesus here. Matthew 28:18. And Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority. All, that means in every sector, in every sphere, all of that has been given to me. Where? In heaven spiritually and on earth naturally. Now here is the shout, if you haven't shouted yet in the message on tonight. Luke 10:19, he says to his disciples, behold, I give you authority, come on, to trample on serpents, I feel my help now, and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm you. Tonight I came to tell you, you have the authority. You've got the authority for those of you who are connected with Jesus Christ, who is connected with the Father. He is in him and we are in him. Thereby the same authority the Father has been given to Christ has also been given to us. Don't you tolerate anything from the devil in this season. Don't tolerate sickness or disease. You have the authority. Don't tolerate poverty. You got the authority. Don't tolerate insurrection. You have the authority. Don't tolerate rebellion. You've got the authority. Don't tolerate lies and deceit. You've got the authority. Don't tolerate struggling in finances or marital discord. You've got the authority to be reconciled, to bring healing. You've got the authority. Somebody type it in. I have the authority. My God in here. I feel a preacher about to come on. It's Bible study. So listen, our authority is not independent from God. Whenever we experience losses in our lives or setbacks or hiccups or mess ups, we may need to check our relationship with the Father through the Son. I got to make that one large on the screen. If you don't get nothing else I said tonight, this is it right here. Whenever we experience, come on, losses in our lives or setbacks or hiccups or mess ups, we may need to check our relationship with the Father. Somebody type it in. Relationship. Check your relationship with the Father through the Son. Type it in on the thread tonight. Type it in the chat tonight. Check yourself. Check yourself. Check yourself. You might need to check where you are in your relationship with him. Come on, let's roll tonight. So now listen, all authority is delegated. The Father to the Son. The Son, come on, to the Holy Spirit, and then the Holy Spirit who lives in us to us. That's the flow right there. That right there, my friend, that is the flow. So here is tonight's word tonight. I said all of that to get here. So how do we stay connected to walk in the authority that has already been committed to us? Here is the first key tonight. Keys to staying connected. We must experience first deliverance ourselves. Come on in here tonight. Deliverance. We are still, all of us, in some area. We're still in need of some area of deliverance. We must be delivered, look here, in our minds and thoughts from ways and words of this world, it should say. From ways and words of this world, or his world meaning Satan's world. 90% of our Christian faith, 90% of our Christian living is first done with the mind first. When you look at Romans 12:2, come on, what does it tell you? To be transformed, do not conform any longer to this world, but to be transformed, why? By the renewing of your mind. Come on, number two, keys to staying connected. We must stay disciplined, here it is, in discipleship. If there was one I was gonna make big on the screen, it's this one right here. We must stay disciplined in discipleship. All too often, we are easily shifted away from the word. Come on, look at it. Worship. Come on, check it out. Walk and our witness before God. The times we are in make it easy for us to begin to drift away from that. Look at this right here. John 8:31-32. What did Jesus say? He said, then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, it's not enough for you just to believe. Look at it. If you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. Watch him now. And you shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free. No wonder, my friends, there is such an attack on the word of God. Such an attack on the tenets of our faith. such an attack on how we believe the way that we believe. Satan understands, if we continue in the word, if we stay in the word, if we submit to the word, if we follow the word, when you put the word and the spirit together, my God, therein lies your authority. I hope somebody is hearing this in word on tonight. Come on, type in for me, even on the replay, stay in the word, stay in the word, stay in the word. Here we go. So here's the last one. Keys to staying connected with Christ, who is in the Father and the Holy Spirit in us. Here it is. How to take up space, by whose authority? We must remember to decree. Here it is. To legislate was what that means, is to create space of authority with God's word. We must decree God's word back to him over our situations. You got to speak that word. Come on, you got to talk that word. You got to live by that word. What demonic entities respond to is the word of God in context by faith built in us. I got to make that one big on the screen, because that right there, if I were preaching, I would say, preach, black man. That right there, that's it right there. That's it. What demonic entities respond to is the word of God. Come on. In its context, what that means is by principled living, principled understanding. That thing has got to be built on the inside of us. When that word is built in us, what they are responding to is the same thing they responded to with Jesus. He was the embodiment of the word. So when they saw him, they knew and realized that he defeated them, not so much in the supernatural, but he defeated them by the word of God, the Father. I'm trying to tell you how to get free in the varying areas of your life. It's that word. Come on. So listen, they in and of themselves, they know the words. Demons don't trip. They know the scripture. They know the word. Come on. The Bible reminds us of that. But now, they're not submitted to the word. So they can quote it, but they ain't going to live by it. It's the living by it that produces power. It's the living by it in situations. Applying it under pressure produces power. My God in here. Come on, here it is. But it's in the word. Look at that. Remember the seven sons of Sceva? Come on, remember them? Let me do that. They tried to do what Peter and Paul were doing. They tried to quote the word and perform miracles and heal people and do all that. Finally, they got tired of the sons of Sceva trying to duplicate it without having it built in them. And so all of a sudden we cast you out of this little girl in the name of Jesus in whom Paul preaches. Look here. The demons responded back. Jesus, we know him. Paul, we know him. But who in the ham sandwich are you? We don't know you. You've got to be, the only way you are recognized in the spirit realm is by applying the word under pressure that produces power in your life. My God in here. Somebody type it in, stay in the word. So listen, the only way Christ is formed in us, that word is formed in us, is that we must receive him first. You can't receive him. You can't receive him and operate in that word. You can't have that word work for you. You can't have that authority that the Father has, that he's given to Christ, that Christ has given to the Spirit, that the Spirit has given to each and every one of us that lives in us, unless we first receive Jesus. So tonight, I want to talk to you tonight about receiving Jesus first, about receiving him into your heart, about making him the Lord of your life. Come on. I want to pray with you tonight as we land the plane, as we say. And I want you to begin to open up your heart and to begin, if you want this kind of authority that's already been given to the believer. For those of you who are watching tonight, for some of you, you already know Jesus, but you need to make a new commitment to him about obeying the word under pressure. And others of you, you don't know him. And tonight, I want you to come in relationship with Christ. And I'm going to pray with you tonight. Come on, this is me virtually locking hands with you through the screen. Come on, I'm praying with you. I'm holding your hands. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for my brother and sister tonight. Come on, say this with me. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner. I need a Savior. Lord, I'm confused. I'm distracted. I'm bothered by the world going on around me. But I want this authority, this power that you've given to the disciples. I want that power of the Holy Spirit resident on the inside of me. So I yield to your word and I yield to your way. Come in my heart. I change my mind about how I thought life ought to be lived. And I want to live for you each and every day from this point forward. Come on. In Jesus' name, somebody say it with me. Amen. Amen and amen. Listen, if you prayed this prayer tonight, I need you to literally go to www.dow.church and I want you to begin to look for the green flyer and I want you to put your information up in. 4 videos open up of us walking you through what it means to be a believer. Send us an email. Send us a message on our Facebook page. We want to keep in touch with you. We want to help you grow. Listen, if this word blessed you tonight, I'm telling you, this is the kind of word you ought to share with somebody. You made it out. It's giving time right here in the Walk of Dominion. Listen, we're still feeding every Sunday after service and every Saturday right at 9 a.m. Want you to make sure you sow your seed right there at our website or on the Walk of Dominion. That's right. Cash App, Walk of, D-O-M-M-I-N. You can do it right there. Look here, got to make it large on the screen for you. Make sure that you connect in this weekend, calling all women. Catch Lady, that's right, Saturday morning at 10 a.m. And also catch up back with us on Sunday morning. That's right, for our celebration of the survivors right there, Sunday morning, 10 a.m. Don't miss it. Invite somebody. Register online. We'll see you then. Make sure you remember, this is our year to be godly aligned and godly assigned. God bless you, my friend. Take care. Bye-bye.